वेलकम नोट बाय राजगोपाल सर।
वी आर लाइव इन 5 4 3 2 1। वी आर लाइव।
चार्जर लोन
यस सर। राजगोपाल सर
वी आर लाइव सर। यस
ओके थैंक यू। गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। इट्स माय प्लेजर टू talk the give the welcome address for our last Indian Orthopedic Association postgraduate training webinar. We will be concluding this webinar series with this. The last official program will be the postgraduate teaching session in the Indian Orthopedic Association annual conference. First of all, I will like to welcome Dr. our president Shiv Shankar and Dr. Navin Thakkar, and President-elect Halter Secretary and President-elect Dr. Ramesh, and Vice President Dr. Atish Basu. I'm sure they'll be joining in later because there's another program going on. They will be joining in later. It'll be my pleasure to invite Dr. Bhaskar Anand, close friend, and Dr. Anil Bhatt, also my close friend. And it's a really pleasure to have two great faculty for our last session, and I'm sure our students are going to benefit a lot. So this sessions, these two sessions, the session is meant entirely for postgraduates, even though there are many consultants logging in. So our aim has been to tell them right from the first year resident to the final year resident what will be useful for them in their knowledge and in the examination. And also I welcome Dr. All the members of the postgraduate training committee. Dr. Rajesh Gupta will join a bit later. Dr. Paresh and Dr. Uday are here. I also welcome all the others who have joined. Dr. Pandian is joined here. And I also welcome all others who have joined here. And we will be going into the program, saving our time. And just for information, sir, the questions answers are not direct. They have to only message and it will be given to you. So it may be, for example, if the first speaker may ask the question later, sometime even we keep it in the next session, that may not be possible. So question answers will come in the chat mode, which we will, one of us, if I'm not there, Uday or Dr. Paresh will, will inform the faculty about it and we can give the answers. With that, I hand over to Dr. Uday to continue the session.
I couldn't open.
Sir, good evening, the allied faculty, eminent faculty here, and my dear colleagues, Paresh Rawal sir, and Rajesh Gupta sir, and Sugin Sogar. Sir, good morning to you, Rajagopal sir, Vicarium States. Good morning to you from all of us. And it's my pleasure to introduce the eminent faculty today, the regents, and the student of a regent. And it's a very rare opportunity to see the teacher and daughter on the same platform. Form the webinar. Thank you so much, sir, Bhaskar sir, and Anil Bhatt sir. And now it's my, I'm just sure. It's my honor to introduce one of the regents in orthopedics, and Dr. Bhaskar Anand Kumar, MS Ortho, D Ortho, Consultant Ortho Surgeon. Presently, yes, he is the visiting consultant to this hospital, Tejaswini Hospitals. Sir, this entire CV has been given to me by Ajit sir, Ajit Prasad sir, Bhaskar sir. So it's my pleasure to read out the legendary Bhaskar sir's CV. Bhaskar Kumar, MS Ortho, D Ortho, former professor, Department of Orthopedics, Consultant Orthopedic Surgeon. Hand Surgical Services, Kasturba Medical College and Hospital, Manipal, Karnataka, India. And then his academic quality, he did his MBBS from Government Medical College, Bellary, Karnataka University. D Ortho in 1970, Manipal. And appointments, I joined an assistant professor in 1974. Professor in other department. And in 1989 to 1994. Director of postgraduate studies in 1992 March Director of Artificial Intelligence Medical Center Survey, Manipal, from 1990 to 94, and Associate Dean, 1994 to 95. Former teaching faculty in the Biomedical Engineering section, Manipal Institute of Technology, Manipal. And visiting professor for the Birds and Dwarka Tirumala Venkateswara Institute of Rehabilitation Research and Surgery, Durga Sanjeevani Hospital, Karnataka, and is a life member of so many associations. And there are so many awards to his credit, Stanley Johnson Fellowship in Microsurgery at Northwick Park Hospital and Clinical Research Center, London, and visiting fellowship to London, Linda University Medical School in California, interlocking engineering training in Strasbourg, France, 1922 October 1991, and visit to Hamburg, Germany, on invitation from in 1991. And he has received many awards, and one of these he has given an oration, Vagyasod oration, in annual conference of Andhra Pradesh chapter of Indian Orthopedic Association, Guntur Medical College in Guntur, 1996. I was an assistant professor then. And there are many felicitations has been given to this sir. Distinguished Young Person Award in 1983, Tulukota Sangri Award in 1989, felicitation by Madagon Citizen under the leadership of Jnanapet Award in 1992, felicitation by Pratibha Rangasimoga in 1992, and by Kannada Sangha Varoda in 1991, and by Tulukota Baroda 1994, Tulukota Bombay 2011, Lifetime Achievement Award by JCS in 2011, and Teachers Day in 2013. And his hobbies are Yakshagana, and I am fortunate to watch him in giving the program in Kerala Cochin Conference. And I think most of us have the same similar experience like me. And achievement, there are many achievements in the field of science and technology, and a larger series of studies on congenital hand anomalies, radial club band, thumb reconstruction, pulsization, mirror hand. And he was the secretary for KOA, president for KOA, president of Indian Society of Surgery for Hand in 2003 to 2006, and co-author in the test book of G.S. Kulkarni test book. And literary work, Bhishmana Konaya Digalu, and another, there are many literary works also to this author's credit, and many orations. And this is the publications. The Indian can see the Anil Bhats are also there as part of the publications. And these are the innumerable number of publications. For the passage of time, I cannot go through all these publications. But the benefit of the youngsters, I made this PPT, because the youngsters has to learn from this master teacher. So he has a role model for many of our youngsters, including the younger generation. So to inspire the younger generation, I took time to prepare all this PPT, all these achievements. And this is the, you must be remembering, sir, you came to 2008 Visakhapatnam when I was the ordinance secretary for the Wasapcon. I was here, sir, when you were right, and left our another resident, Dr. Shantaram Shetty, sir. And I also take a lot of pride and pleasure. Yes, can you come here, Sunny? Please stop sharing it. Yes. And also take the privilege introducing another eminent teacher, Dr. Anil K. Bhatt. Are you able to hear me? Sir? Hello?
We can hear you, Uday, nicely.
Video phone. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Right, sir. So, Anil K. Bhatt, MS Ortho, DMB Ortho, MNAMS, Associate Dean, Professor and Head of the Hand and Microsurgery Department, KMC Manipal.
Uday, we can't see the PowerPoint.
He did his MBBS from... Uday, that's what. PowerPoint. Yeah, PowerPoint. And what can be checked? Any question? Now, is it okay, sir? Sir, are you able to see?
Yes, we can see. Please carry on.
Hi. Okay, sir. So MS from KMC Manipal, specialized in upper limb and hand surgery, and is the assistant professor from 1999 to 2004, associate from 2004 to 2012, professor of KMC Manipal from 2012 to date, and associate dean from 2019 onwards, head of the department of hand surgery from 2021 onwards. The current position, the chief coordinator, Hasta Center for Congenital Hand Differences, Manipal Academy of Higher Education, clinical editor of the hand, American Society for Surgery of the Hand, coordinator, 3D printing center for hand process for artificial limb center, Kasturi Hospital, Manipal. I think, sir, Anil sir, you are doing along with the Amir Reddy, this research project. Am I right, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Chief editor, Journal of Karnataka Orthopedic Association. Special interests are wrist disorders, including wrist arthroscopy, conjunctive hand differences, tendon reconstruction, elbow disorders, and sports injuries at the upper limb, endoscopy, carpal tunnel release, 3D printing of hand process, and research work, PhD guide registered at Manipal University. He has got 83 international publications, 374 scientific presentations, guest lectures, 32 academic and thesis, 17 funded projects, 6 fellowships, observerships, author of one book and co-author are chapters in 2 textbooks, and thesis guide for postgraduates and guide for a PhD projects and ICMR student projects. Really amazing CV, Anil Bhatt sir, really should inspire our youngsters. And he received the fellowships, SS Babulkar Fellowship by the IOI 2002, College Jesus Fellowship in 2003 from Ganga Hospital, observership from the National Hospital Singapore from March 2006, and KAY Indo-UK International Traveling Fellowship and Department of Orthopedics Queen Elizabeth Mother Hospital in UK 2010, Robert Ekran Fellowship in 2012 from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And this is the really amazing. Thank you, sir, for this opportunity. Your talk, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, you can share your screen, sir, now. Bhaskar, sir.
At the outset, I must thank the organizers for having invited me to deliver this talk. Though I have said examination of nerve affection of the upper limb, I am not touching upon affections round about the shoulder. For example, following brachial plexus. So scapular muscles or shoulder muscles, I am not touching upon. Basically, the peripheral nerves. Looking at the attitude of the hand itself, sometimes we can make out what is what. If there is a claw hand involving mainly the medial 2 fingers, we can make out whether it's low or high depending on its position. Median nerve, all of you know that if it's high, you'll get pointing index. In radial nerve paralysis, you'll get the wrist drop. And if it's purely a posterior intraosseous in nerve injury, then you get finger drop. Now, claw hand, what is claw hand? It's nothing but hyperextension of the MCP joint and flexion at the PIP and DAP joints. Why it happens? Because we know that the flexor of the MCP joint is the lumbricals. When the lumbricals are paralyzed, the MCP joint goes into hyperextension. And to counter that, the flexors will work and will produce flexion at the PIP and DAP joints. And the parody is that if there is mild paralysis, means if it is lower down near this joint, clawing is very severe. If it is high injury, then it is not all that severe, as you see here. If you see the hand on your left side of the screen, it's a mild clawing, secondary to a high nerve paralysis. It's because the profundus is also involved. And it's not flexing the DAP joint, unlike in low paralysis where profundus is spared, and that's why The clawing is very severe. Now, muscles paralyzed. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. The muscles paralyzed in ulnar nerve injury are, if it is high, all the muscles supplied by the ulnar nerve, that is flexor carpi ulnaris, flexor digitorum profundus, all the hypothenar muscles, all the interossei, adductor pollicis, and lumbricals, the medial two lumbricals are paralyzed. If it is low, of course, flexor carpi ulnaris and flexor digitorum profundus are spared, and the remaining are paralyzed. Flexor carpi ulnaris, I don't have a picture to show you. Otherwise, what we have to do is flex the wrist joint, deviate to the ulnar side. At that time, the prominent flexor carpi ulnaris can be seen. Flexor digitorum profundus, if it is involved, we have to test like this. We have to immobilize the action of the PAP joint flexion by keeping it straight. And when you ask the patient to flex the DAP joint, you are virtually testing for flexor digitorum profundus. If it is absent, it means that it is paralyzed. Regarding hypothenar muscles, abductor digit minimi and flexor digit minimi are to be tested. The abductor digit minimi is tested by asking the patient to abduct the digit in the plane of the palm. That's very important, because if they hyperextend the MCP joint, the extensor can substitute. If they flex it, flex the MCP joint, even the flexor can substitute. And this action can be mimicked. So it's very important for them to keep it in the neutral position and abduct it. And you can see the muscle puckering at the medial aspect of the palm. Now, palmar interossei in outpatient can be tested by a quick test called CART test, which is very popular. But the fallacies are that the examiner and the patient should be using the same digits. For example, here we are testing the right hand of the patient by the right hand of the surgeon, and index as well as the middle finger are being used. If you want to test the interosseous between middle finger and the ring finger, once again it should be the same, because the power in the other fingers could be different. This is the right method. On the contrary, this is the wrong method, where the examiner is using the opposite hand, and even the fingers are not identical. If you want to test the power of the adductors or abductors, you can stabilize the digits in the neutral position at the MCP joint, and then offer resistance at the middle phalanx in the opposite direction. Why middle phalanx? Because they are ultimately acting at that level. This is, if you flex the MCP joint during this test, it gets substituted by the flexors and the thumb. So this is the wrong method. So you should ask the patient to keep always the MCP joint in neutral position. Similarly, dorsal interossei are first tested by a quick test like this in that patient. Or if you want to really know the power exactly, you can test it individually of each digit. Substitution by the extensor, you can see here, patient is awfully abducted. So much so sometimes patient's digit itself can be in that position where the extensors are very powerful and deviating it more laterally. Coming to the testing of the adductor pollicis, adduction is an action both in the perpendicular to the palm as well as in the plane of the palm. And we should know that this action, it assists in extension of the IP joint also. So quick test in the outpatient is called the book test, where you hold the book like this, and the patient is asked to, when the patient is also asked to hold it during the remaining part of the hand and the thumb, and you pull it. During pulling, if there is a paralysis of the adductor, the substitution occurs by the flexor pollicis longus, as you've seen here, where the foment sign is positive. Coming to the lumbricals, their main action is flexion of the MCP joint, keeping the remaining digits straight. When you ask the patient to flex the MCP joint, offer the resistance, you can test the lumbricals. just few examples of ulnar paralysis. A classical tardy ulnar paralysis can happen because of the tibetus varus valgus deformity, where increasing angle produces a slowly increasing paralysis of the ulnar nerve, as you see here. Another place where it can be compressed or divided is in the Gwyn's canal, where distally it is a low ulnar paralysis that you get in the Gwyn's canal. We'll not elaborate on that. Now, all of us know about the median nerve injury, that is the pointing index. This is a pointing index case, but however, it happened to be a 25-year-old nurse who came with a history of inability to bend or move the index finger. The residents made a diagnosis of median nerve paralysis. However, people failed to, our residents failed to see a small wound at that region, where she said that a small scissors has got in, and so following which she had got it. On exploration, we found the digital nerve as well as the flexor tendon were injured, and repair was done. So all pointing index are not. Muscles paralyzed in median nerve injury are pruritus arteries, flexor carpi radialis, flexor pollicis longus, flexor digitorum superficialis, and flexor digitorum profundus of the lateral two fingers, that is index and the middle finger, pronator cortatus, abductor pollicis brevis, and oculus pollicis. If it's a high injury, all these muscles are paralyzed. In low injury, it spares except the abductor pollicis brevis and oculus pollicis. I'm not talking all these things to save some time. Coming to flexor pollicis longus, it is very important that while testing, we should stabilize the thumb by pushing the metacarpal towards the palm and proximal phalanx away from the palm. At that time, if you ask the patient to flex, it is purely the flexor pollicis longus that is working. Flexor digitorum superficialis, you nullify the effects of the remaining by extending all the remaining digits. And when you ask the patient to flex that particular digit, you can it gets flexed only at the PAP joint. So much so, if you tap over the tip of the finger, it wobbles, saying that flexor profundus is not working. Coming to adductor pollicis brevis, this is adductor. This should be an abductor, I think. Anyway. Abductor pollicis brevis, abduction of the CMJ joint, the plane and perpendicular to the palm. It assists in extension of the IP joint. Perpendicular to the palm is the abductor pollicis brevis, which when affected, you will see this muscle is totally paralyzed and it is flattened because of median nerve injury. And if there is clawing of all the digits, think of so many other possibilities. Median nerve and ulnar nerve involvement, affection of the T1, involvement of the involvement secondary to pancreas tumor or thoracic outlet syndrome, and Klumke's paralysis, of course, motor neuron disease. All this can produce clawing in all the four fingers. Coming to radial now, triceps, brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis, extensor carpi ulnaris, extensor digitorum, and selective supply to extensor indices proprius and extensor digiti quinti minimi. Lastly, extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, and abductor pollicis longus. All these are supplied by the radial nerve. In high ulnar paralysis, including triceps, may be affected. Somewhere in the middle, if there is an injury, let's say in the groove, then triceps is spared and the remaining muscles are paralyzed. In low paralysis, in fact, the up to ECRL and ECRB have been spared and the remaining muscles may be paralyzed. Triceps is how we test the power. Brachioradialis, you can see on the lateral side of the arm near the elbow, it stands out and at the breaker is standing out. We have to keep the forearm in mid prone position, otherwise it can be substituted by other muscles. Extensor carpi radialis, longus and brevis, are tested by asking the patient to dorsiflex and radially deviate. Individually, testing the carpi radialis, longus and brevis is not all that practicable. In testing for the extensor carpi ulnaris, you have to ask the patient to deviate the dorsiflexed hand to the medial side. Testing for extensor digitorum, keeping the wrist in neutral position, ask the patient to flex all the digits and try to extend the MCP joint and offer the resistance at the distal part of the proximal phalanx. Then you will know you are testing the extensor digitorum. Now, testing individually, because we have separate extensor for the index as well as the little finger, you flex all the remaining digits and extensor, the index finger is kept straight, and you offer the resistance at the middle phalanx. At that time, you are testing extensor indices proprius, because the extensor digitorum effect has been nullified by flexing the remaining digits. Similarly, for the little finger, where you keep the flexion of all the remaining digits except that of the little finger and test for the power of the same thing. Testing for the extensor pollicis longus sometimes is difficult, because often this extension can be done by many other muscles which are getting attached to the extensor expansion, such as adductor pollicis, abductor pollicis brevis, also can extend extensor pollicis brevis. All this can extend to the expansion and extend the IP joint of the thumb. So it's very important for us to stabilize the thumb, keep the CMC and MCP in extension. And at that time, when you ask the patient to extend, you will be extending only the extensor pollicis longus. False positive, as I said, if you flex the MCP joint and try to do that, patient will be able to extend the digit. Extensor pollicis brevis, you test it by flexing the MCP joint, keeping the IP joint straight, as the patient extends. At that time, you are testing the extensor pollicis brevis. Coming to abductor pollicis longus, you should know that ask the patient to abduct the thumb at 45 degrees to the plane of the palm, because we know 90 degrees to the plane of the palm is done by the abductor pollicis brevis. Longus is done at the angle of 45 degrees. So keep the thumb in that position and offer the resistance. Just to show you that abduction can be done in the plane of the palm by the EPB, 45 degrees to the plane of the palm by abductor pollicis longus, and 90 degrees to the plane of the palm by the abductor pollicis brevis. Just giving you some examples. This 30-year-old male presented with a wound on the arm was referred to me saying that it's a radial nerve injury. They had primarily sutured it and sent it to me immediately. That is the attitude of the hand. You see the finger drop, but the thumb is in extension. Little finger is also in extension. This cannot, though they have said with the wrist drop, there was no wrist drop. It was only a finger drop, that two of the three digits in the center. And as I told you, this is neither a radial nerve paralysis nor a posterior interstitial nerve paralysis. On a closer look, you see there is another small wound which they have sutured here. Actually, the culprit was this wound. This was exposed, and we realized that extensor tendons of the middle ring and index finger were found to be cut. The tendons were repaired, and the function was regained. So, what is the message? If there is a wound, take it for granted that structures underneath are injured unless proved otherwise. It's my usual statement. Know your anatomy well. Anatomy to the surgeon is like geography to the historian. So it's important that in all these things we should know our anatomy. Yeah, small wound there. If you see in a 25-year-old male with cloying, wound there, a combined ulnar as well as median nerve paralysis. Because if you see here, that is the area wherein the median nerve also can be damaged. That's why you have clawing of all the digits. There is introitus atrophy, volar pulpar atrophy, flat palmar arch, and clawing of the fingers. Another case, 30-year male, this is a stiff affair. See the two wounds there? Yeah, I think I will not go into much of other details. This is only a tip of the iceberg. I touched because I was given only 30 minutes. I thought if I include everything, it will be too much. So I shortened the talk. And thank you very much indeed. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your words of you, sir. This all, but we want to listen. Everybody wanted to listen from you. And this mother testing also, the excellent demonstration. And then any questions are there? Rajesh Gupta, sir. Welcome, sir.
Dr. Uday, I think questions will be at last because questions from delegates would come via chat. So let us proceed with Dr. Anil Bhatt.
Okay. Good evening, Rajesh Gupta, sir.
Good evening, sir. Sorry, bit late. Good evening, sir.
We completed Bhaskar sir's talk.
Actually, stuck up with some patient, you know, in the clinic. I wanted to be in time, always in time, but somehow.
Sir, Anil Bhatt, sir, I think you can go ahead
with your talk. Yes, thank you so much.
Is it visible, sir? In concluding, sir, yeah. I can understand. Why are you doing this? What?
Can I start?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, Ayukon and Ayukon BG committee also, especially Rajgopalan, sir. I think today I'm sitting with two of my bosses. Not many people might not know, I worked briefly at St. John's before joining Manipal. I was there for a month. Dr. Rajgopalan, sir, was my HOD at that time. And then, so I have this privilege of having both my bosses here today. So thank you so much for this, Ayokar. Examination of the wrist is still not really in the mainstream of the examination, which is taught to the postgraduates. Examination of hand is taught, but the wrist as such is neglected to a certain extent. And so I thought I'll choose this so that we can go a little more detail, and then I'll follow it up with the case of a malunited distal radius fracture, which is a very common case kept in the examination as a short case. So the usual story is basically most wrist injuries are treated with as sprains and minor injuries even now. That's basically because of the complex anatomy. Patient is usually put on a slab or a splint, but then major injuries are missed like this. Something like this. Patient comes back with pain and stiffness and instability after a period of time. And sadly, most of our young patients, a lot of times these are very young patients. And wrist joint is a complex itself. The radiocarpal joint, it's like, you have many, stories or, ground floor, second floor, first floor. So you need to look at that as the, so if you look at this, this is the radiocarpal joint, which is basically the basement or the ground floor itself. And you have the midcarpal joint, then you have the carpo metacarpal joint, and then you have the basement, which is the distal radial joint, which a lot of us forget. So these are the areas where we have to look. So it becomes a very complex anatomy here. And that is why this becomes difficult to diagnose. And if you take out the layers of these things, so if you take out the skeleton itself, you have these intercarpal ligaments. So these ligaments are very important, and most of the wrist pathologies happen here at this point, intercarpal ligaments. And then you have in the capsule, just below the capsule, you have these long, big ligaments. These are called extrinsic ligaments. The first one is the intrinsic ligaments. And then you have the capsule itself. And then you have the covering tendons and, you know, digital vessels and nerves and everything going out. So this is how the anatomy forms right from skeleton to up to the skin. And so a lot of structures, any of these which are closely packed here, is the one which causes problems. So approach to the wrist is basically history, as everybody knows, to look at the mechanism. The most important thing is a proper clinical examination, and then only we go to the imaging. It could be from X-ray till MRI and arthrogram, and now arthroscopy also. So this is how we look. But for a postgraduate, the methodical risk assessment is always the same in every joint. Look, feel, move, measure, and provocative test. Here I say instead of special tests, I say it as provocative test, because in the wrist, we need to do some tests which are to elicit pain again. So looking at these, both the wrists here, you see one is, there is a swelling here, the dorsum also is swollen, the wrist is also swollen, the skin changes. If you see, here it's a normal wrinkling of the skin, and here you see the swollen skin, shiny skin. You just have to move the wrist sometimes to bring out the pathology, something like a ganglion here. Only if you move and come down to the palmar flexion, you might see this. Sometimes you might see swellings like this. Prominent ulna like this talks about so many things. It could be rheumatoid, it could be just acute distal radial ulna joint instability. So many stories are there. It could be a mid-lungs deformity. So any of these can be there with a prominent ulna like this. The most important diagnostic tool in the wrist examination is feet. And it has to be systemic in the sense that we need to have your own way of examination. Either you go from radial to ulna, or proximal to distal, dorsal to ulnar, and painless to painful area. And also, as I said, dynamic palpation, which means move the wrist as and when possible and see at different points where you can elicit the tenderness. Most cases present are, we can classify as radial-sided pain or an ulnar-sided pain or a central or a diffuse wrist pain. And develop your own pattern of examination, which gives you the maximum information. That's very, very important. A lot of times, the pathologies are in the carpal bone. So every carpal bone, you should be able to examine. The most common, obviously, is the scaphoid fractures are common. Non-unions are common. Patients come with this. So the waste of the scaphoid is, if you take this, the Lister's tubercle, I call as a lighthouse for the wrist. That is where all these, you can start your examination and start palpating different. So distal to the rim of the distal radius towards the styloid here is where the waste of the scaphoid comes. And in an anatomical snuff box is classically taught for postgraduates or undergraduates, but actually it should be in ulnar deviation. So if you look at the wrist, if you just, you know, if you see the C-arm picture of the wrist. So you'll see that when you move, actually you put your finger into the scale point, it actually goes somewhere here in anatomical snuff box. So you have to do ulnar deviation of the wrist. And then only you can be able to actually feel the waist of the skin. Is there some dissonance there? So when you do the waist palpation, make sure you do it in ulnar deviation and not just in the neutral position. So that's very, very important. Now, the proximal pole is, again, here the Lister's tubercle. And then you go just distal to that. There's a sulcus, which is the radiocarpal joint. And then the prominence is the scapholoric joint. And then go more towards radial side. That is the proximal pole. So imagine the wrist, the scaphoid has three parts, the waist, the proximal pole, and the distal pole. All three parts have to be palpated for you to make sure that you have palpated the entire scaphoid. And the distal pole is on the ulnar side. It is not on the dorsal side or the radial side. As you go along the FCR tendon here, you have the bony prominence here, and that is the distal pole of the scaphoid. So there are all three parts of the scaphoid has to be palpated for you to know whether the scaphoid is injured or not. Waist is a common, of course, but proximal pole and distal pole can also be injured. So please remember that. The lunate palpation is along the third metacarpal. So if you take the lunate, So there is a Lister's tubercle there. Okay, that is your point. But then as you palpate along, if you just palm off flex like this, the lobate becomes prominent here. Okay, so that is along the third metacarpal again, you can come down and then you can palpate the lunate. So it's not in the neutral position, palpate the lunate. You'll have to palm off flex and only the lunate comes out and you can palpate the lunate. So that is an important point you need to remember with this. The triquetrum is on the ulna side, and if you palpate that, so you have this is the point there, and along the ulna styloid, if you go, it's deep down actually. It's quite deep down there. So again, if you move the wrist early, the triquetrum comes out. So if you move towards the radial side, the triquetrum comes out, and you can easily palpate the triquetrum. Again, a lot of times there could be injuries to the triquetrum, and there is a malassigned kind of pain, and so you need to know that clearly. Pisiform, I'm sure everybody knows. So it's basically along the FCU tendon. So you palpate along the FCU tendon, and then the first bony prominence you feel there is a pisiform there. So that is what it is seen. So a lot of times, again, when patients fall down, they have tenderness. You should be very careful looking for the pisiform fractures. A lot of times it's missed. Special x-rays are required there, and you need to palpate that and make sure that there is no injury to this. So these are very small things. That's how patients keep going around everywhere because somebody is not palpating them properly. The trapezium and trapezoid are hidden bones in that sense that they're quite deep. So again, along the first metacarpal, if you palpate, just below that is your the trapezium bone. So along the first metacarpal here, base of that here, if you palpate the trapezium bone, and that is how we need to palpate that. Sometimes with the scaphoid or with the Bennett's or you know, so many other injuries, the trapezium could be damaged. So it's very important that we palpate that clearly when patient has pain somewhere in that particular area. So always we need to know where the patient has pain and see what anatomy is below and then try to palpate for this. Trapezoid is just adjacent to that, but it is along the second metacarpal. So trapezium is along the first metacarpal and the trapezoid is along the second metacarpal. Just basal to that is your trapezoid there. So both of these, especially trapezoid, is one which is completely kind of hidden bone. It's very difficult for you to get injured the trapezoid, very rare for the fracture to happen in the trapezoid, but then sometimes it can happen. And then the big bone there is the capitate bone. So the capitate is along the third metacarpal, here. So just below that, you will see this big bone here for palpation, and that's how it needs to be palpated. It's a quite large bone, and sometimes it could be injured even in very low kind of dislocations. So again, try to palm off, flex it, and see if you can palpate this nicely there. So that is the capitate. And this is the hamate. Again, hamate has two portions. So make sure that one is on the from the dorsal side you palpate. So that is the body of the hamate itself. Most of the time that is not injured. So body of the hamate along the fourth metacarpal, you will get. So that's very, very important. The most common injury is actually the hook of the hamate. So the hook of the hamate needs to be palpated, which I'll show you soon. So this is where the hamate palpation happens, which is the body, which is the dorsal palpation. However, the hook of the hamate is the one, as I said, which is commonly palpated, which is commonly injured. And that is along, if you palpate the pisiform, just one finger breadth towards the ulnar side, if you go, deep down is your palpation in the hypothenar eminence, you have the hook of the hamate. This is along this line here. If you draw this, it's along this line here. And a lot of times, the hook of the hamate fractures are often missed, and patients come really late. And then you need to take special carpal tunnel views for you to actually diagnose the hook of the hamate fractures. So, as I said, palpate these bones, normal bones, these are all normal palpation. But when a patient comes, we basically divide them as different types or sites of pain. This is the radial sided pain, this is central pain and ulnar pain. So if you have the radial sided pain only.
Dr. Anil, there is some audio problem, yeah. You know, there is disturbance.
I'll just
there is a lot of audio problems. Sorry.
No, it's okay. I'll switch off the video. I think my internet is quite slow.
That must be the issue here. Actually, quite important things, you know. So.
Yeah. Thanks for letting me know. Is it better now?
Not yet. Maybe net issue only. But.
Okay. Can you give me a couple of minutes? I'll log in through another internet. But meanwhile, if there are any questions, if you can take that. Is that okay?
Better. Log in again, please. Better.
For Dr. Bhaskaran Kumar. Yeah. Sorry.
Rajesh sir, there was some confusion today.
What?
That's written as Friday.
Yeah, Friday, Sajid. No problem.
Then I have to send a correction to all the groups today.
It's all right.
All the groups, I made a note of it.
Yeah. No problem. These are minor things, you know.
Supriya, can you tell us how many people have joined today, log in today? Supriya?
Yes, sir.
How many people joined today, postgraduates?
Oh, sir, I'll have to check that with you, Dr. Sir.
Okay, no problem. No issue.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah, audible.
Better than before?
Better, yeah, clear, a little bit clear, yes.
Okay. So the radial sided pain is basically, we need to, as I said, take different structures here. Bone is here, scaphoid and the distal radius. The joint is a radiocarpal joint. It can also be CMC joint. The major ligament which is injured is the scapholunate ligament here. It could be tendon problems, decoherence or intersection syndrome, and the nerve you take is a superficial radial nerve. So if somebody has a radial sided pain, these are all the things which could be injured or damaged. And as I showed you the examination or the palpation of each of these bones, plus a couple of other tests, like we have tests for scapholunate and decoherence, we need to do that. The clinical examination, as I said, is the Lister's tubercle, and then the scapholunate interval here, if you look, from there, we check the EPL and APL and the EPB, the first dorsal compartment, scaphoid, all these which I've already shown. So that is how the clinical examination goes here. Now, if you look at the central pain here at this point, again, so the scapholunate ligament is a major one. The first compartment is a major one here for the radial sided pain. And then you have all these things. The provocative test will be the Finkelstein's test for the decoherence. The other test called the Eschoff's test and the Watt test, that is the wrist hyperflexion and abduction test, which is more specific. We also do what is called the radiocarpal grinding, Watson's test and SL bellotment, and finally CMC grading. So these are the ones, so this is how the Watson test is done from ulnar to radial deviation. When you put your pressure here and palpate, you will feel a clunk there if there is a scapholunate instability. So this is the grind test, holding a metacarpal and grinding here. So in CMC arthritis, you will have this. And this is the bellotment, scaphoid and lunate. You hold it and you bellot. And you can make out if there's any instability. Now, if you'll come at the central pain, the central side, you have basically the bone is the lunate here. So you have the Kienbox disease. You can also have the distal radius here. Ganglions are very common in the central area. The lunate, scaphoid lunate is still the problem here. Tendon EPL is crossing somewhere here. EDC is there. Both are the problems. And the nerve is posterior interosseous nerve and stops here. It ends as a pseudoganglion and stops here. So there could be neuromas there. So lunate, as I said, palmar flex, if you do like this and palpate, lunate is difficult to palpate. So if you palmar flex, as I showed you in the clinical photograph, then the lunate comes out. Even the ganglions will be common here at this point. That's how we need to palpate these things at this point. Ganglion, as I said, palmar flex, and it becomes prominent. The majority of the patients actually come with ulnar sided pain, a very common problem. And there's a lot of structures there. So if you see the ulnar styloid, the hook of the hamate, which I showed you, and the triquetrum, joint-wise is the distal radial ulnar joint here, very common joint. And then you have the ulnocarpal joint. Ligament, the major ligament is the TFCC ligament here, and a big ligament which stabilizes the distal radial ulnar joint. And you also have the lunated triquetral ligament. Tendons ECU and FCU from both extensor and flexor side. For the nerve, Guillain's canal is one. For the artery, you have hypothenar hammer syndrome, which is basically a kind of a repetitive injury for the ulnar artery there, which causes thrombosis of this. So again, at this point, if you take and extrapolate it on to the MRI itself, you have this distal radial ulnar joint, you have the ulnar styloid, and that is where the TFCC comes here from the fovea here. It attaches here on the ulnar aspect of the distal radius and stabilizes the distal radial ulnar joint. And that is the lunated triquetral joint and the ligament itself. So there are tests again which you have to know in this, which will again cause forced pronation and supination. Supination especially causes a lot of stress on the distal radial ulnar joint. This is called an ulnocarpal grinding test. Distal radial ulnar joint ballotment, you all know piano key sign. Press test is basically axial loading of the distal radial ulnar joint. Of course, the lunated triquetral ballotment. And the pisiform, which I told you sometimes is damaged, or there might be arthritis between the pisiform and the triquetrum. So we hold the pisiform and do a grinding. So these are the tests. So this is one of the common tests, which is very, very important, which is called as a foveal sign. And this is what we check for TFCC ligament injury. So this is the soft spot here, just distal to the ulnar styloid. And pisiform is here, ECU is here. So here is where you have the fovea. And so tenderness there means the TFCC could be injured. So that is very, very important. It's a very sensitive test. Ulnocarpal stress test again tells if there's a problem along the ulnar side. So this is the radial grinding, that side. And if you do it on the ulnar side, this is the ulnocarpal stress test or the grinding test. And if patient has any problem on the ulnar side, then usually it will be quite painful for the patient. So these are the provocative tests we do for the ulnar side. Press test is this. This test causes a lot of stress on the distal radial ulnar joint. If I ask the patient to get up like this, holding like this, that causes a lot of axial loading of the distal radial ulnar joint. So, but the better test is this. This is what happens routinely for patients. When they get up from the chair or the bed, there's axial loading on the distal radial ulnar joint and patient gets severe pain. So when you ask the patient to do this test, press test like this, modified press test, this is called, there'll be a lot of pain, and you know that there's a problem with the distal radial ulnar joint itself here. Distal radial ulnar joint ballotment, piano key sign. So hold the radial column completely and then ballot this like this, in all the directions, neutral, pronation, and supination, all three directions, and see where exactly the instability is happening. So when you fix the distal radius fractures, you have to do this always. And sometimes it's very unstable. You have to pin the distal radial ulnar joint. So this is the piano key sign, actually the way to do it. Hook of hamate palpation, I've told you already. So a lot of times a missed fracture. So you need to know that. Movements, compare always with the opposite side, both dorsiflexion and palmar flexion. Don't forget pronation and supination. And center of capitate is a center of rotation for all goniometric measurements. So in summary, you should have the 3D concept of the wrist anatomy itself here like this. And bone and soft tissue components, which I told you, radial side, ulnar side, central wrist pain or diffuse wrist pain. Diffuse wrist pain is most common in arthritis patients. You need to be systematic and precise at each level. As I said, each story of the wrist, basement, first floor, second floor, you know, you need to go like that. Always correlate with clinical symptoms. don't look at the MRI report and then tell somebody has a problem. Always make sure that you correlate with the clinical symptoms. And if somebody is doing a wrist arthroscopy, you should go and find the problem there based on a clinical symptom rather than an MRI finding. And always examine before reviewing the x-rays. Don't look at the x-rays first. Clinically examine and then take a decision and correlate your clinical findings with the x-rays and not the other way. Thank you so much for your attention.
Dr. Uday, unmute yourself.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sir, check any questions are there. Thank you, sir. Anil, sir, any questions are there, sir? The chat box.
We will have to find out from Supriya if they have received in chat box any questions. Supriya?
Sir, on YouTube, as of now, I cannot see any questions in the chat box.
Okay. All right.
I think if there are no questions, I think Sir can go ahead with the case presentation.
Dr. Anil, I think very nice presentation. You know, this is quite elaborative. Usually, our standard book is as thus. Everybody reads it, you know. I must have read 100 times. Then, you know, all these signs are not there in that book even.
Yes.
Yeah, all these signs are not there. There is hardly any sign written in that book. But it is very, very important because most of the time we are missing many, many, you know, things in the wrist. Especially on the ulnar side, there is a problem, you know. We pass it as a, you know, sprain of the ulnar collateral ligament, then go ahead. But I think there is much more than that. Number one. Number two, I think one thing is, missed. I don't know whether you have touched it or not. Level of the ulnar stenoid process is, I think, very important in distal radial fractures.
Yes, sir. I'll be illustrating that in the case discussion
okay.
Now.
Okay, no problem.
Yes.
Okay. So that is it. Okay, carry on, please.
I'll just share my screen for the...
Hello.
So one of the common, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, one of the cases kept is a malunated distal radius fracture. Generally elderly female patients, history of fall 3 months ago on outstretched hand. The common history is always treated non-operatively in a plaster cast and now comes with deformity, limitation of movement, and pain in the wrist with decreased grip. So these are all very, very important symptoms you should ask the patient. Patient tells, I have deformity, limitation of movement. She won't be able to do certain activities. Pain sometimes might be there. And also very, very subtle finding like a decreased grip will alert you with something sinister happening there. So these are the things which you need to check. If you look at the hand itself, there's always the deformity which you see. If you see this is the classical manus valgus deformity for the postgraduates. So if you look at the upper limb in anatomical position, the wrist is going towards or the hand is going towards the radial side. So that is why it is called as the manus valgus deformity. So you should check that in the anatomical position and then you will start seeing other things. And during inspection, you should look at the attitude and the deformity. So as I already told, the deformity is basically a manus valgus deformity here. And this is, as I said, the hand, the distal part of the limb beyond the joint is going towards the midline. Away from the midline. That is what you should show in the anatomical position. So that is why it's called as a manus valgus deformity. And then you start looking at different things. So you see, this is the deformity here. Okay. So that is how it goes there. And then on the ulnar side, in the anatomical position, it's going away from the midline. So this is what you see. And if you see from the lateral aspect here, you will also see the other deformity, which is there is some amount of dorsal bump there, which is basically the classical Dinofolk kind of deformity. Dinofolk is actually described for the acute, but otherwise, if it malleates in the same position, you can still call it the same kind of deformity. And then you look for skin changes. This lady came, if you look, there is some amount of dryness of the skin here, right? And some amount of swelling there. You look for muscle wasting, especially in the thenar, especially with distal radius associated things, both thenar, hypothenar, both median and ulnar nerve, you need to be carefully looking at. The distal limb itself, what has happened here, if at all there are any changes, there is edema there or color changes or any trophic changes, especially in a long-standing nerve injuries, you will always see the trophic changes. The trophic changes are basically nail changes, the brittleness of the nail, chipping of the nail, loss of hair growth, loss of sweating, and sometimes limb length discrepancy. Palpation-wise, always starts with temperature tenderness. Please always, postgraduates, always start this palpi. In any area we're doing, you always talk with temperature and tenderness. Tenderness here is the distal radius itself. And as Dr. Rajesh was telling, the normal bony landmarks, that's very, very important. And I'm illustrating that here, that if you look at the level of the styloid process, the normally it is the distal, the radial styloid is always distal to about 1 to 1.5 centimeters. In this lady, it's almost normal. If you see, it's almost not normal, it's almost equal. They almost are the same. This is how we need to palpate and show the examiner that, and sometimes it could be reversed also. So if you see here carefully, the ulnar styloid is probably a little more distal than the radial styloid, which means the entire relationship is actually reversed. So this is what you need to show the examiner, the normal bony landmarks, what has happened to it. And as I said, for your malunion decision, the most important is thickening of the bone. The thickening of the bone, tenderness of the bone, or irregularity of the bone. These three things should be there. Tenderness might not be there always, but thickening and irregularity will always be there. So these are the things you have to tell if you want to tell it's a malunion. So the thickening and tenderness. So palpation is the most important step here. And then check the movements. Okay, see what is restricted here. Palmar flexion, dorsiflexion. All these have to be checked and recorded. And radial and ulnar deviation. So all these again tells if there is a dorsal malunion, you know that the palmar flexion will be limited here. And you know that sometimes here the radial deviation will be ulnar deviation will be limited. So any of these will change your decision. Without looking at X-ray, you can make out all these diagnoses. The most important point for distal radius malunion is your pronation and supination. I'm sorry about the videos which are changing direction. So pronation and supination is very, very important to be recorded and check the range of motion exactly and record both sides, document both sides, because you know that the distal radial ulnar joint is disrupted when you have a distal radius malunion. Neurovascular examination, she said some grip strength. So always make sure, see if there's any thenar wasting here. This lady has some amount of thenar wasting here. So the moment you see that, check for the median nerve function, which has already been told in the previous talk, especially a simple pen test to see the APB power, whether it is. So patients might not know that actually when you check very objectively, then you will check for opponents, you check for abductor pollicis. There might be some weakness starting and they might not realize that in the beginning if the median nerve is slowly getting involved in these patients. So all these have to be checked for and some special tests. Already I have mentioned all these for distal radial ulnar joint, the press test itself. This is the old one, that is this is the new modified one. And this how earlier we used to do this. So a lot of axial load, also the piano key sign, which I told you, which I already showed you. So these are the special tests for this particular case. So for you to say that there is a problem in the distal radial ulnar joint and the foveal sign, as I said, so that could be a problem there. So that is the fovea there, and that is where the TFCC could be injured. So every distal radius fracture, there could be injury to any of these things. Please remember that. And a lot of times, distal radius malunion patients come with ulnar-sided pain. They won't come with radial-sided pain. They will come with ulnar-sided pain because TRUJ is disrupted, and also TFCC could be injured in these patients. Look for complications, which is carpal tunnel syndrome or CRPS. That's why I said, look at the skin, look at other things, swelling and trophic changes. It could be the complex regional pain syndrome, what we used to call as pseudexatrophy earlier. But these are the things you need to look for. So you know it's a malunited distal radius. You have to give the reasons why. So a history of being conservatively managed in a cast. So there are chances of malunion are higher. Patient comes with a deformity. And then on examination, you have this ulna styloid, radial styloid is changed the positions. There is thickening of the bone, irregularity of the bone, range of movements are restricted. So you need to add up everything from the history, clinical examination findings, and then tell that is why it is malunion. The question we ask as examiners will be, what will you do now? So you need to always tell X-ray. Please don't jump and say, I'll do a corrective osteotomy. Always say, I'll take an X-ray and confirm my diagnosis. Okay, so this is how this lady actually presented on day one. And she was put on a plaster like this. If you see, even in the plaster, the reduction is not complete. So if you don't reduce it in the beginning, obviously it will go for malunion. The fracture unites nicely always because it's a cancellous bone, corticocancellous junction, a lot of good blood supply. So even with some osteoporosis, they still unite nicely, but they will malunite. So post-reduction, 3 months, you see this collapse which has happened. And clinical examination showed this. The radial styloid is now more proximal than the ulna styloid. And there's a dorsal malunion like this. So all of you know this theory part. What are the normal radiological parameters? You know, inclination, volar tilt, radial length, all these things. But for this patient, it's always the opposite side. So remember when they ask, somebody asks, what is normal for this patient? When you do a corrective osteotomy, you should tell it is the opposite side. So always in malunion patients, we take the opposite X-ray and draw the indices. And that is what we need to recreate for this patient on the affected site. But there are clinically acceptable reduction. Radial height should be less than 5 millimeters, inclination 15 degrees, palmar tilt, and articular incongruity. That is the most important thing. Patient should not have an articular incongruity, which will lead to eventually to arthritis. So this is how we actually manage this patient. We draw the normal side indices, what has happened, and what has happened here on the, in the abnormal side. So if you look at the angle here, the height here is 1.12 here. It is actually reversed here at this point, right? Even in the lateral, we take the palmar tilt here and it's almost 8 degrees here, but it is, if it, this 17 is actually minus 17, it has gone reverse actually. So we need to achieve this back at least to the neutral position. So when we ask again, how will you manage the patient? As I said, X-ray is the first and treatment. So treatment, a lot of times, sometimes this is not the same patient, it's a different patient. Even though X-ray looks normal, sometimes there could be restriction of movement and everything. And so your CT scan sometimes is helpful in these. See, in this patient, the CT scan actually shows a problem in the sigmoid nodule, which is not seen on the X-ray. But patient had reduced distal radial ulna joint movement. So a malunion here in the volar corner and causing incongruity of the sigmoid notch. Treatment options, any malunion, the answer should be a corrective osteotomy. The types of osteotomy is different, but at least you should tell that the treatment option for a malunion is always corrective osteotomy. In this case, there could be an option for ulna shortening. But if there's a malunion with arthritis, then salvage procedures comes in. So a lot of times patients come late and the pain is because of arthritis. Primarily, malunion is painless. Remember that. But if patients have developed arthritis or there is malalignment in lower limb, especially, and that causes pain. Malunion per se, because the bone is united, they won't have any pain as such. Surgical approaches, when somebody asks corrective osteotomy, I'm just going a little beyond the normal. I should be stopping at this, but I'll just run through the surgical steps. Because this lady had carpal tunnel symptoms also, we went through this. This is called the extended FCR approach. We open the carpal tunnel here. Release the carpal tunnel, the nerve, and then you see this is the malunion. See, if you see, you need to get a 3D concept of the bone. So especially on the dorsal aspect, there'll be a lot of additions here. So that needs to be removed, all these. So this is the malunion dorsal aspect here. I'm on the extensor side. All these periosteum, everything will be stuck. This fragment won't move unless you clear all these things. And then you mark your osteotomy here. And then you do the osteotomy. If the original fracture line is visible, that is good. Otherwise, you keep a good. And this is how we do the osteotomy, and this is how we correct it. So the first wire should go along the axis of the joint, and then you create an angle based on what you had measured earlier, and you use the plate to get this. Correction of the volar tilt here. So we fix the distal part here, and then. Come down with this push the plate down so that you get the volar tilt here. So plate is used to get the correction here. This is the osteotomy done already there. And this is how, that's the angle which was calculated preoperatively, the dorsal tilt. So that is how you recreate by keeping the same angle here. And when you press this down here back, you get this back, the dorsal tilt is nicely corrected here. Okay, so that's how it goes. The gap is there. You can put in a bone graft there. There's a large amount of graft, but with the volar plates, locking plates, even with the small amount of graft, you don't require a graft here. So that's how it is corrected there nicely. And so this is after the reduction, we have got back the indices. So that is the main aim. Even on the lateral side, we have got back the indices. So that's what it's, if there is a lot of radial height reduction, sometimes we do a ulnar shortening. So generally the rule of thumb is more than 5 centimeters, then it's better to do an ulnar shortening rather than trying to get the height here. So that is what you need to tell. But in arthritis, when patient comes, which is again, they come with ulnar-sided pain, you go for salvage procedure. There are many salvage procedures. Kapanjis and directs are very common ones. Kapanjis procedure is where there's an arthritis here. So we fuse this joint and we open up here, creating a gap there called a pseudarthrosis there. So Kapanji and Sove and Kapanji are actually teacher and student. And that is what probably today's session is all about. So this is how we create this. This is where we fuse this joint here. I've put a cannulated cancellous. This is the pseudarthrosis, which is opened up here. And that's how they get the, and then that distal part of the ulna becomes, it becomes unstable. So you create a sling with the help of an FCU and that sling will hold it down. So this is an important step to do in a Kapanji's procedure. That's how the sling is tightened here through the bone. And you put in a couple of screws and decorticate this area nicely and then fuse this joint. Directs, again, good old directs. But the problem is, again, ulnar translation of the carpus because there is no support here. And this goes and impinges here. This is called the radioulnar impingement. So directs is reserved only for certain small amount of patients, if at all. Even the ulnar head is damaged here completely, then we go and do a directs. Otherwise, the Kapanjis would be good enough. So palpation is the most important part of the examination for you, for any short case for that matter, when bone is involved. Look for complications. Management according to the patient disability and DRVG status. So only malunion, do a corrective osteotomy. If patient has come with arthritis also, then go for salvage procedures. Thank you so much.
Rajesh sir, any questions? Supriya, any questions are there in the chat box?
No sir, no questions as of now on YouTube.
Dr. Anil, I think very, very nice illustration of the things, in this case also, so many points covered. Anything you want to tell about the ulnar variance, it comes in that?
Especially the neutral variance and negative variance are a common occurrence in a lot of normal people also. So we might have negative ulna variance. So basically we are looking at the articular surface of the radius and the ulna and then comparing if there's any difference. If they're at the same level, it is the neutral. If the ulna is more proximal, it is usually negative, which is usually up to 2 millimeters is even actually taken as normal. And very rarely you can have a positive ulna variance. But when it becomes pathological, we end up with problems. So if there's a gross negative ulna variance, so one of the thing is etiology, which is postulated is Kinbox disease, which is basically where there is no ulnar support there for the lunate. So it creates what's called as a nutcracker effect. And so patients might develop lunatomalacia. If the ulna is positive, like a distal radius malunion, so where the radial height is reduced and the ulna is more prominent or rather more distal, it leads to what's called as ulnar impaction syndrome. So radioulnar impingement is different. Ulnar impaction syndrome is different. Ulnar impaction means the ulnar head is now touching that lunate corner there. And there is an arthritis starting. So this is called as ulnar impaction. What I told about radio ulna impingement is in a direct procedure where the stump of the ulna is now hitching on to the radius whenever there is pronation and supination. So that is radio ulnar impingement. So these two terminologies we have to be clear. So positive ulnar variance leads to ulnar impaction syndrome, and patients do come with wrist pain, ulnar sided kind of pain, and the answer for that is an ulnar shortening basically.
Yeah, great. So I think they should know, PG should know about variance about, because sometimes an examiner can ask about this, you know.
Yes. So,
yes. I think direct osteotomy is out now for all practical purposes.
Yeah, my indication is only when there is a ulnar cartilage is also damaged. Sometimes we have ulnar head fractures. So, and then there is also in sometimes in rheumatoid patients. So that is where we use directs very sparingly. If it's DRUJ is the only one involved, I would go for Kapanji. But if the ulnar head is also damaged, so sometimes there'd be foveal fractures, ulnar head fractures, associated distal radius fractures. And sometimes there's a malunion with the neck also. The neck, ulnar neck, a lot of times people don't treat that. They would do the distal radius fixation and it's left behind. And that goes for malunion, finally arthritis. So those are times you take off. But there, one additional point is, like Kapanji, you can stabilize the distal ulna also with a FCU sling. Then the problem of radio ulnar impingement will not happen. So that is one thing we can do even with a direct procedure. Not just take off the ulnar head and come out. You give a soft tissue sling, that patient, those patients will do really good with it.
Okay.
So the Kapanji step is used in the directs.
Yeah, okay. That is all right. What about fixation of ulnar steloid process? You know, some people, they say fix it also. Some people say leave it when we are doing the percutaneous spinning or something like that, or fixing a distal radius.
Yes. So as I showed you in the DRUJ allotment, after every distal radius fixation, you have to do the ballotment and see how stable the distal radio ulnar joint is. Now, there could be situations where there's no ulnar fracture at all, styloid fracture. So in ulnar styloid, you have the ulnar styloid tip fracture and the base fracture. And if a displaced base fracture means we should assume that TFCC is also avulsed from there. So it's like an avulsion fracture. But TFCC can also be torn without the ulnar styloid fracture also. So it's your clinical judgment. So after your distal radius fixation, there is an ulnar styloid fracture, base fracture, and the DRUJ is also very, very unstable. I think it is wise as a surgeon for us to sleep, you know, soundly in the night. You can fix it and then be happy with it. That is my way of looking at it. So it takes another 5 minutes. You need to open up. It's not a closed procedure. Please not to put a K-wire through the ulnar styloid because it's an avulsion fracture. No way it will reduce it back. So you should always make a small opening there on the dorsal ulnar side and make sure there's a dorsal sensory branch of the ulnar nerve that needs to be protected, because these are the problems we face later on. So, and then you see, visualize the fracture and then fix it back to the fovea there, to the ulnar head. So that gives a lot of stability straight away. If there is no fracture, or even if there's a fracture, but your DRUJ is quite stable, because there are many secondary stabilizers also. It's not just TFCC. It's the ECU, so many pronator quadrators. All these are secondary stabilizers, even an intraosseous membrane also. So it's quite stable. Then you just have to put them in maybe above elbow slab for 3 weeks and then convert it to a below elbow cast for another 3 weeks and start mobilizing them. So it's purely a clinical or intra-op decision. One important thing is also to check for ligament laxity in these patients on the opposite side. If required, you change your glove, go to the opposite side, check the ligament laxity, come back, and then if you want, you can fix it. So these are things we do sometimes. Otherwise, it's not that every ulnar styloid should be fixed. That is not the philosophy.
That's all right. Good. Dr. Anil, last question. It is regarding, you know, decision-making when we are treating, you know, distal radial fractures. Especially we say colis fracture, you know, home to operate and home to do fix, you know, close reduction and casting. This is a very, very difficult decision, you know, in our scenarios, because sometimes we do close reduction and casting, and after 6 weeks, it is all collapsed. Even if we have done 3-point fixation and all those things, then what are those patients whom should we immediately operate and whom should we can wait? Is there any criteria for that?
Yes, sir. So at the end of the day, I want to know whether the fracture is stable or not. So that is where my decision happens. So stability of the fracture is very, very important. So there are criteria for that, the stability of the fracture. If there is more than 50% displacement, if you look at the dorsal displacement, that is one criteria. If the radial height is less than, reduced more than 1 centimeter or 10 millimeters. If there is a distal radial joint, I mean, as I said, ulnar styloid base fractures. If the bone is osteoporotic. So these are all things which we have to look for, or if there's comminution at the fracture site. These are all the criteria for, well, this is Jupiter's criteria actually for stability of the distal radius fracture. Now, close reduction and cast is more difficult treatment than putting a plate and forgetting about it. If somebody is put on a close reduction and casting is done, they have to be followed in the first 3 weeks, every week with an X-ray. So a lot of times what happens, we put a cast and we ask them to come at 6 weeks and we know it's collapsed inside. So if you have put a cast, every week the patient has to be called, and patient has to be told at any point of time, I see a collapse, I see the radial height is settling down slowly, there is a change or a displacement, we will go for an operative procedure. So 3 weeks, every week we call the patient, we take the X-ray. After 3rd week, if it is still holding, means that was originally a stable fracture. So to start with, it was a stable fracture. At any point of time, this doesn't happen even with a young, I mean, even with an old patient who is 60 or 70 year old, but then it's, no, because I operate more of DRUJ malunions in older patients. It's not that they do well. You know, they all come back telling, I can't even tie my hair. Please get me relieved of this pain. So just today we had a lady we operated, same simple things, but we assume that all elderly patients, we can accept the malunion. No, we can't do that. So it all depends on the physiological age rather than the chronological age, what they are doing daily. If this lady is the only one in the home who's doing all the cooking and everything, she will be completely disabled. So at any point of time, we do a close reduction and cast. They have to be monitored and the stability should be checked preoperatively only. And the decision has to be taken. And if patient is not willing for a surgery, we should tell them, counsel them, document that it might go for malunion and they will have problems later. This is how I decide, sir.
That is all right. I think issue is acceptance of the patient for surgery also. You know, most of the old people may not agree for surgery initially.
Yes.
That is also a big point, you know.
The only thing we can do is document, counsel and document. That's all we can do.
And we have also seen that. Can I add a point here?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah. Usually my habit when I treat these patients conservatively would be, say, after 1 week or 2 weeks, check X-ray is must. That is true. But even if plaster has become loose, but the reduction is maintained, then I would like to change the plaster.
Definitely. Definitely.
So that will give us more surety that reduction, what we have achieved, is not lost.
Correct. Correct. So at 2nd week, you can still reduce it a little with a good sedation and all, if at all there is some amount of collapse. And then by 3rd week, they'll start, kind of healing. So we always tell the patient, second week is the time I tell them that I will take a decision whether you might want a recasting if the cast has become loose once the edema has subsided, or you might go for surgery also. And it could be just a Kapandis technique of wiring or K-wires if they were not really keen for any other major injury. This one, I'll tell them it will be just a close reduction. So there is a borderline cases where they're not very unstable, but you know that it is slowly collapsed. And those are the times you can just put in a couple of K-wires and hold them with a cast, and they will do quite well. External fixator definitely is out of my practice for a long time now. So we don't really use external fixator. If it's only a decision between a cast with K-wire versus a plating. Otherwise, there's no in-between there for us. I mean, a lot of people might disagree with that because a lot of people still use a lot of external fixators, but ours, in our practice, at least, it's just limited to maybe open fractures sometimes. Yeah.
And one basic question from me, Tatanil.
Yes, sir.
So what is the height of this radial styroid and ulnar styroid? It is the difference is 0.5 centimeter, 1 centimeter, 1.5 centimeters.
It's anywhere between 1 to 1.5 centimeters. So it's always, again, compare with the normal side of the patient. So each of us have different things. There is always a range, but it's never less than 1 centimeter.
Okay. Then, as a old timers, we still treat our distal radius fractures if they're stable with cast. And among the above, do you advise below elbow cast or above elbow cast?
if you tell me it is stable, then below elbow cast is good enough. There is no role for above elbow cast. If I do an above elbow only after I've plated and I have also know that there is a distal radial instability, only for the 3 weeks, because soft tissue healing takes about 3 weeks. So it could be, as I said, intraosseous membrane, pronator quadratus, ECU, TFCC, any of these will take about 3 weeks to heal. So that is where I put them an above elbow plaster and convert to below elbow straight away at 3 weeks and start mobilizing the elbow. And another 3 weeks later, and at that time, the wire also will come if I put a transfixation wire. And then 3 more weeks later, I'll start mobilizing them.
One more question, because you said this just is out of your practice, but we do a lot of K-wear fixation and with just. What is your comment on that?
Sir, if your external fixator is...
Because we are not very good at this plating, so we prefer to do, especially there is a combination is there, we prefer just K-wear fixation plus with supporting... reinforce with just. What is your opinion on that?
Yes, sir. Why my objection for external fixator is a lot of people will rely on external fixator with ligamentotaxis, even though there are fragments which are not moving because of that. So you have a central depressed fracture with a lunate facet or any of these comminuted fragments. If you look at your check x-rays, if your radiocarpal gap is more than 2 millimeters, between the radius and the carpal bones or between the mid-carpal, means that is an excess traction which has happened there. That should not happen. If a fragment has to move within the less of this traction, then it means it is an ideal case for ligamentotaxis. But if you're putting in so much traction, this patient definitely develops stiffness and CRPS and other problems. That is one thing. So very few indications for external fixator in that sense. If you augment, as you said, that is a good way. If you augment the external fixator with K-wire, specific fragments you fix with K-wire and use the ligament without too much distraction, it's a good method, no problem. In those cases, you remove the K-wires a little later, you know, for those fragments which are holding nicely, and then remove the fixator early and start mobilizing them because your fixator will span the joint. So remove that early. Those K-wires can be there for 1 more week, otherwise it will collapse. The settling down happens the moment you remove the fixator because of that. So keep those K wires for another couple of weeks, but start moving the joint and the MCP joints and the wrist joint. So that is one strategy of doing it. So this is how you need to use the external fixator cleverly. Otherwise, if you rely only on external fixator, complications are more if the indication is not correct.
And finally, from me, what is your protocol for CRPS?
We have a very specific protocol, sir.
Sir, sorry.
Based on the evidence, what we do now is basically we don't give any of these depressants and things like that. No muscle relaxant. Those are all not useful. So we have looked at the level of evidence. The highest level of evidence is for one is vitamin C. Second is NSAIDs can be given. Third is what is called as mirror therapy, which we use with the help of occupational therapy. There's a specific therapy. I wish I can show you that. I have a talk separately for that. But there is what is called as a mirror therapy, which which is proven and which is very, very efficient for CRPS. Drugs-wise, bisphosphonates is got good evidence. Then you have, if you want to go slightly for an intervention kind of thing, you can have ketamine or a brachial block kind of a thing. Sympathetic kind of ganglion block sometimes works. If the first one doesn't work, it won't work. So rarely we use that, but we rely more on the NSAIDs, vitamin C and bisphosphonates, and to a certain extent, pregabalin. These are the 4 drugs we use. Rarely we use steroids, but antidepressants, all these kind of things, muscle relaxants are of no use.
Dr. Anil, there are papers for comparison, you know, plating, you know, operative versus conservative. And yes, some of the papers show very good result on, you know, with conservative treatment. What do you take on that?
I think today somebody shared a new systematic review of 2021. I think almost 7,000 patients odd. This is the new latest systematic review, which is just in print right now. And they say there's absolutely no difference between any of these things. So even the draft trial, which is the one of the big trials, also showed that K-wire versus plating, there is no difference in terms of any kinds of outcomes at the end of 1 year. So yes, it all depends on the initial part also. So we should not tell that at 1 year, everything is same. We should also look at the patient and say at 6 weeks, what this patient has to do. At 3 months, what this patient has to do. If the patient is agreeing to not do much of work at 6 weeks, then your K-wire is still good if you're good at your K-wiring. But if the patient wants to get on with his work at 6 weeks, you know, I think plating is a better choice. So the decision making should involve the patient also. That is very, very important, which we don't do most of the times. So we should look at short-term results in that sense. At 6 weeks or 3 months, what the patient wants to do in terms of his occupation or sports or whatever it is. Studies statistically might show a lot of things. It might show no difference at 1 year and all. These are all number games, basically. But we should look at our own patients. So if a lady tells, no, I want to get back to my work because I'm the only one working, she will be better with the plate rather than a cast and K-wire and then, you know, stiffness and other things. So in that sense, I think it should be patient-based and we have to sit with them and find out what they want. That's a more pragmatic approach, I feel.
Yes. Thank you.
Dr. Anil?
Yes, sir. Anil, yes.
There is a question from one of the delegates, Dr. Bala Avinash from Vaisakh. His question is, actually I covered this, but still he has asked, so it's my duty to tell you. His question is, when to do only ulnar shortening, osteotomy, any criteria and what criteria you follow, sir? When to do only ulnar shortening, osteotomy, any criteria and what criteria you follow?
Yeah. So when I know that my malunion correction will be very difficult if there's a lot of shortening of the height of the radius. So I generally take as a maybe a 4-5 centimeter cutoff there. Actually, if you look at the literature, they tell us 6 centimeters actually. But if I'm using a lamina spreader and then pushing the fragment there when we are doing the osteotomy and trying to get the height of the radius. So I put a small lamina spreader in the osteotomy site and I distract and get the radial height. Now, a lot of times this is not possible because the soft tissues are contracted and everything. So if anything more than 5 centimeters, I would just do the ulna shortening and get this back, because in upper limb, again, we are not really worried about the length. So some amount of shortening is tolerated by the patient. So it can be done. But if it is less than 5 centimeters, I would try to give the normal anatomy back, which is getting the radial height back. And for that, as I showed you in my slides, the dissection is very important, especially on the dorsal aspect where the periosteum, the extensor retinaculum, all are stuck there because of the old injury itself. So you have to clear all those things. Then only this fragment will move, the distal fragment will move after the osteotomy. Otherwise, it won't move so easily. And you end up with an undercorrection. And using a lamina spreader is a very easy thing. You can just put in there and then just distract it and keep it for five, 10 minutes. You just hold it there. All the soft tissues get stretched nicely. And I put a K-wire from the ulna to, I mean, radius to ulna, so that we hold that there only and then put the plate so that I don't lose my reduction. So just at the subchondral surface, I put the K-wire, thick K-wire, 1.5 centimeter K-wire, hold that reduction what I've got, and then I put in the plate. So that is how it can be done.
Thank you, Dr. Anil. Dr. Bala, I hope, thanks for the question and hope your answers are good.
Sir, you are muted, sir.
Sorry. Dr. Bala, please, if it is clear to you, fine. Otherwise, please inform. Please proceed, Dr. Uday.
Subin is not there, sir.
From Dr. Bala Avinash. Okay, Dr. Uday, please proceed.
Dr. Uday, you proceed.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
If there are no questions, I think Subin is there. Subin is not there. I think we shall propose vote of thanks and conclude the session.
Yes.
And then first of all, my on behalf of the IYO teaching committee, from Rajagopalan sir, Rajesh Gupta, Rajagupta sir, Paresh Rao sir, myself and Subin sir, we immensely thank Shivashankar, our president, and Naveen Thakur, our secretary, for giving us this opportunity to conduct this PG teaching program. And then I immensely thank today. It's really a special occasion, a teacher and student really sharing the platform, and very memorable occasion. And thank you, Anil sir, for joining us and sharing your knowledge with our youngsters. And Bhaskaran sir has to leave because he called me and told me that, informed me that he wanted to leave. So from our, on behalf of the committee, we immensely thank the legend, Dr. Bhaskaran Kumar sir. And lastly, our best wishes to all our post graduates. We have followed our teaching programs, and I think they will be taking their exams in another 2-3 months. Our committee wishes them all the best. Again, I suggest every one of you, please don't lose the opportunity of learning, because once you finish your MS, where you get very little opportunity to learn. Now that competition is very tough, and also I always take our own people as role models. Our own Bhaskaran Kumar, our own Benjamin Joseph sir. There are so many our stalwarts are there in our own, India. So you have to take them as a role models. And you can, today I purposefully prepared the CV of Bhaskaran Kumar sir, and from Anil Bhatt sir has given a short CV, but I went to the net and prepared all the details of him, and prepared only for the benefit of youngsters. So the youngsters will follow the seniors like you, Anil sir, and then they also, they will inspired, they want to become like you. So that is the my aim of preparing all these this CV. In fact, in my seminar hall, I recently hanged all our Indian scientists only. All the 13 scientists belong to our own India, our Indian eminent teachers. I did not put even anybody from our outside India. But of course, there are outside the wall, there are many people. But the seminar hall, purposefully, I kept Rajasekharan photo, Ingalalkar photos, Benjamin Joseph, Shanmugh Sundaram, Natarajan, and everybody, Dolakia sir, everything. That's what my aim of, my way of looking at the teaching for Anil sir. And once again, our gratitude to you for all the faculty, especially all the faculty joined earlier also. And I thank my colleagues for joining this program. Anything more from the Rajesh sir, Rajagopal sir? Any comments from you, sir, Rajagopal sir? Your concluding remarks.
Sir, unmute, sir. Sir, unmute.
Dr. Rajagopal. Sir, unmute, sir.
Still Dr. Rajagopal, sir, unmute.
You're still muted, Rajagopal. Yes, sir.
Sir, unmuted again.
Dr. TV.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Supriya and Shamsul and Ashok.
And Neeraj.
Okay, sir.
We should conclude the session, sir. Thank you once again, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
To you, Rajagopalan sir, and Rajesh sir. Good night, sir.
Yeah.
Paresh,
good night,
sir.
Good night.
Sorry, sir. Paresh.
Bye to everybody. Thank you, Anil.
Thank you, Anil. Hope we shall meet at IOCON, sir.
Yes, yeah. Thank you very much.